Beth, what a beautiful schmata.
You know, the two of us, we think alike, don't we? I mean, look at us both showing up in glasses and a hat. I'll tell you, the reality is because I've been running around all day doing a bunch of stuff. What's your reason?
I've been doing the whole front gardening.
See, they give us a little time off and we just go berserk on the home front, right?
Yeah, I have stuff to do every day. I rebuilt the treehouse. Well, not the whole thing, but I rebuilt the entire floor and I had to put new braces up under the bottom of it.
You should have done a video of you doing all that.
I know.
Too late, but you should have. Maybe take some pictures of it, the new improved version of itself.
I can do that. Yeah.
Maybe can you build me a little house over here for my grandkids sometime?
Yeah, I can. I'll tell you what, you order one and I'll put it together for you.
Okay. Actually, I just saw some on the internet of a cute little things. Okay, so what are we doing today?
I think we're answering questions.
Okay.
That people have submitted, and I think we got some good questions.
Okay, so, good. All right, I'm ready.
Mandy's going to tell us what they are.
Okay.
All right, well, to get started, the reason we're filming this now is because Days of Our Lives is off the air for...
They're off, because of the Olympics.
Yeah, the reason you're off the air is for the Olympics. So I thought we'd start with two quick.
I've been enjoying the Olympics.
That was going to be my question. Are you watching?
I haven't. I love it. I watch it in the evening, so I don't get it. I'd like to go on the Peacock and see all of it. And maybe I will. TV. Maybe I will go check it out because it's so exciting. The Peacock is carrying it. But I have been catching it at night. And then I don't normally watch TV in the morning, but I've been putting on the Today Show to get some recaps too. It's always so fun. I think I went to the Olympics in 1984 here in California. Did you, Stephen?
No, but I got caught in traffic many, many times out here when that was happening.
Mm.
Remember how bad traffic was over here? Well, you don't live on the west side, but over here
in 1984, I think I did live on the west side in 1984. I did.
Oh.
I lived at Roxbury and Olympic.
Okay.
Yes, before you knew me. We didn't meet till 86.
I know.
Our life changed.
Okay, one more Olympic question. If you had to be in the Olympics and pick a sport as your sport, what would it be?
Swimming, for sure. I've been a swimmer my whole life. I should be swimming now, but I'm not, but I should be.
You love the ocean. You swim in the ocean too, don't you?
I'm a Pisces, but so are you. But I grew up on swim team. So
I love swimming underwater. Do they have any underwater events? Swimming?
I don't know, but you know, my husband and his friend this weekend are taking a like a free diving course. My husband is a total Renaissance guy, I swear. This last weekend he was playing pedal steel in a band in Huntington Beach on the beach.
Right on.
And I have to send you a video of that. It's so cute. And then this weekend, he's going with a guy to take this, a sort of a free diving course where you learn to hold your breath and all that.
Right.
He's spooky. He's a cooker.
I think that I would do high jump because when I was a kid, I was crazy about the high jump. And I set up a high jump.
Really?
With a pole, right. A bamboo pole and the whole thing.
You could have had a whole different career.
And I got pretty good. I actually was able to jump, to get over clear without touching the pole, about 6 feet, 6 feet something.
Wow.
It's pretty impressive. Good.
That's impressive.
And I put a mattress on the other side.
So God. You took this a lot more seriously than I took my swimming. Although I do have a few medals, and I went back about 5 years ago to the master swim, for adults. And I was pretty fast still. I'm still pretty good.
Wow.
I still got it.
Because that is one thing I did not know about you.
Yeah.
That you were
Wally Kurth knows it about me because Wally swims on master swimming in Santa Monica or Manhattan Beach or wherever he lives.
Master swimming, what's that?
It's like a swim team for adults.
Oh.
And they even compete. I think he has competed. I didn't, but.
Cool.
Still pretty fun.
So we got a ton of questions about storyline. Obviously, you can't share a whole lot, but do Steve and Kayla have anything coming up?
We always have something coming up.
Yeah,
a little something.
It doesn't.
We make every scene we have count.
But we're involved in a couple of things. We're just doing our thing. Whatever they give us, we do it.
That's it.
There were also a lot of questions about or comments about Stephanie and Joey. And what are your thoughts about your kids being back in Salem?
Well,
I think it would be
a great idea. We do want them back because not only do we love those kids and those actors, but when they're back, it means we have story because we would love to have some grandchildren. It would be nice to have some grandbabies. Stephanie comes back with a new baby.
I passed you up, Stephen. I'm going on my fourth. Pretty good, huh? Mm-hmm. I just think that Days of Our Lives, one of the great things about Days of Our Lives is the generational story. So I think it would be, swell to do that, to bring our kids back and have them have kids. But we have Trip. So we do have one child in town.
We hardly see him, though.
Well, the day is young. You never know.
So I guess along those lines, somebody asked what sort of storyline you would like to see your characters in. So family, kids, grandkids?
Yeah. I love family stories. What'd you say, sweetie?
Yeah, what'd family.
That's my favorite thing about Days of Our Lives is the multi-generational and the families. And I loved it actually when Joey and Steven came back on the show, when Joey aged. And I loved all those scenes. I mean, I know a lot of people thought that writing was dark, but I just thought it was good stuff. It was a little deeper and we had some good family stuff back then.
After you said deeper, you broke up.
Andy? Oh, I just said we had some good stuff when you and Joey came on the show after we aged Joey up.
Right.
Yeah, that was good stuff.
So you guys have come and gone from Days a couple times each. What keeps you coming back to Days? Like, what is it about Days that keeps you coming
back? Well, I feel like it's our family, don't you, Stephen? Plus, we love working together.
It's a family thing, and it's because we started there. It was our maiden voyage, and so
yeah, it always felt like home. I always wanted to go back.
It feels like home, and it's comfortable. Yeah. It's like going. You're out, you're doing your thing, and you come back to your house, to your home, where your family is. That's the way it feels.
And the history there too. I mean, the Bradys and the Hortons and all that, and the DeMaras. I mean, there's just so much history on that show. Well,
yeah, because we started 36, 37 years ago. I mean, there's a lot of history that we're a part of. Yeah. So it is home.
Yeah.
Can you describe sort of the average day at work now, sort of in the COVID environment, and how that has changed from previous years?
Yeah, what's the first thing you do when you come to work, Mary Beth?
You get tested. You have to find your little barcode to show the guy you check in with. I can never find that. So he's shown me how to put it in favorites.
Oh, honey, put it in your
I know, I'm technically challenged.
Make an album that says COVID, your COVID album on your...
You should show me how to do that. I don't even know how to make albums. They just show up.
Then you get tested, and I'll tell you what we do next. We go to our dressing rooms. And if it's a day when we have to wait, then we have to wait there for hour and a half to 2 hours for our result. What's the next thing you do, Mary Beth?
And then they leave our makeup bag in the room, and we put our own, I do my own face, and then and dry my hair. And then I go to hair and makeup because you only have a certain amount of time in there. And so the makeup.
They have to set a timer for you so that you they can't have you in the chair longer than 5 minutes.
Right. And these are all like Screen Actor Guild AFTRA codes. These are not theirs. But she does my eyes and then I do my lips and mascara back in my room. And then I get my hair done and I go back to my room and then I stay in my room and we only run lines on the phone sometimes we can meet out in the parking lot or something.
Yes, they've changed the rules, but I think it's going to go back to the original way because
the Delta variant. The Delta.
It's getting a little crazy out there.
And then I got an email that we're going to have to test ourselves.
Right. Yeah,
I haven't watched the video, but I guess we have to stick a swab up there or something.
Yeah, they show you, they said the nurse will be with you as you do it to yourself.
I wonder why they're doing that. But you know, I always feel like they don't stick it up far enough anyway. I'm always leaning forward because I feel like it needs to go up further to really grab whatever's going on. But anyway, they're uber safe. They're so careful there, and it's wonderful. And you know what? I feel like we've done this for so long. We get out on that floor, and most of the time they say go to tape, and we do it. And for the most part, I think we pull it off pretty well. And because we're very connected, and as everybody knows, because we've told them so many times. But you know what? I don't care if it's COVID and this and that, whatever. I still really love it there. I love it. I love going there, and I like having my little gig. And it's a fun place. It really is an amazing place to work. The three producers, Randy, Janet, and Albert, are amazing. The girls that are the stage managers, Jesse and Lucy, are great. Of course, Richard Bloor, the costumes, he's beyond amazing. I mean, he had to just do this whole spinoff thing for the Peacock, and it was all people that aren't there. He had to go shop for all those people, and he's amazing. And it's just such a team, and a tight team, and all the crew. It's just a really great place to work.
Well, that's a perfect bridge to our next question. Lots of commentary and questions about your wardrobe, your costumes. How much say-so do you have? Do you pick your own? And then Mary Beth specifically, somebody wants to know about the cute little dresses you wear and where they come. And Stephen, somebody wants to know about the necklace you wear, and does it have special meaning?
Yeah. The necklace, yeah.
Go ahead.
That is my wife, Lisa, had that made for me. It was a gift for our 13th wedding anniversary. And it's an Om symbol. She designed it and had it made by a silversmith. And the chain, the thing holding it, I've gone through several different iterations, but the one that's on there now was made by Kali, the guy who used to cut my hair for 15 years, and he left the country a year and a half ago, so I lost him. But he made the necklace part. So it's special to me, and I like to wear it. It's just kind of simple. Sometimes it's under my shirt, sometimes you see it. I like having that close to my heart when I'm working. And
sweet
costumes, you know, they, Richard will let you wear whatever you want to wear. That's basically it. He'll let you wear whatever. So you know, you tell him, he knows your style. After a while, he knows what you like. And they usually put a couple of options in my room, and I can choose from those options. It's mostly black, but.
Mm-hmm. I know, I've joked. I think I've done an Instagram thing before. You wearing black, and your black clothes hanging on the wall that you're going to put on, and you're in black clothes that you came in. And I mean, it's all very, you know, it's so funny.
I don't always wear black.
I know. Look at you. You look so safari-ish today. It's really nice. He knows my body style, and I like fit and flare. And you can look it up Google it on, Macy's, and it'll come up fit and flare. I'll show you this dresses, but. And he knows the ones that fit me. And so I bet I'm probably the quickest wardrobe fitting. He'll put, you know, four things out, and generally I'll just point to something and I assume it fits, because if it's fit and flare, it usually fits. And a lot of them are Ted Baker. That's just a brand. And he knows that fits me really well. So a lot of them are just that.
And then sometimes he made women's clothes.
Yeah. Oh, beautiful. Almost all the dresses I wear are Ted Baker. And then sometimes we wear something that he pulls out of our wardrobe, out of our stock, they call it. But I'm pretty good about just kind of going, okay, that's fine. And he knows me so well, and he picks such pretty things. And he knows I like, you know, embellished things, or polka dots, or French collars, or bows. I mean, he knows I like all that kind of stuff. So that's what he leans towards for me. But he's so good. He knows everybody's body type there, and everybody's style. I mean, look how Lauren dresses. I mean, she's an amazing zhuzher. I mean, I think that they bring in a rack of stuff for her, and she does the mixing, matching, and the accessorizing, and she's amazing like that. I don't have that skill, but and he shops. He does all the shopping himself. He does not have assistants running out there picking things. So he is truly, truly amazing.
So in both of those descriptions, you talk a little bit about where Kayla and Mary Beth maybe are similar in their taste, and Stephen and Steve are similar, how would you say you're different than your character?
My personality is more casual too, I think. And I think I'm looser and funnier in person. I mean, probably, but that's just, the writing too. I mean, whatever, but I don't know, Stephen, what do you think? I don't know what it is. I mean, Stephen's way, you're way loose. We both have, after all these years, we brought so much of ourselves to these characters. I mean,
that can't be avoided. I think you have to.
Yeah.
And it's at a certain point that when you speak of character in daytime television, because you're doing it all these years, you just sort of, so much of yourself is in the work.
Right.
You can't help but have it be that way. I don't know how else it could be, because basically they're not really writing to character in daytime television. They're really just writing story. So whatever you bring to it, character-wise, is what you bring to it, and nobody is really dictating that,
right?
Especially
because there's no rehearsal, so you're making choices and you're just hoping that your instincts are good. But then they come over and give you tips, or sometimes.
Yeah.
What?
Yeah. Well, when you look at the script and you break it down, you look at the scenes and you do your homework. It's really more about how you're reacting to the other characters and what your relationships are with them.
Right.
And the rest.
And we know these characters so well. And a lot of times the things that we're talking about, we actually did. So, we know we're talking.
In the beginning, because they didn't really have a Bible for this character, it was supposed to be a short-term deal. I brought a lot of my own stuff to it. I brought a lot of my childhood, my upbringing, I sort of...
The name, the Stephen Earl.
That wasn't,
Earl
is that wasn't your, my your idea. Real name. Well, that wasn't my Somebody idea. Else. Earl was, because I wanted to honor my grandfather, who was basically a father to me. But to Steve, that was Al Raven's idea. We were actually sitting in the makeup room the day he said, you're getting a name today. And all the actors were in there. Deidre was in there, Drake, and I think Peter maybe... I don't know if you were there, but we were trying.
I wasn't there. No, you were there. You were there like a year before me or something.
Oh, that's right. We were trying to come up with a name for Patch. Come up with all these really cool names, right? People had great ideas. And Al Raven walks in. He goes, "Well, your name's Steve." What? Why?
I love him so much. He was awesome. He was amazing. So we used to do our scenes, and he would walk out, and he'd go, "Very nice," And back then, the producers came out of the booth and walked out to the set and took their time and said, "Oh, that was great, and you did so great, it was great." I mean, thinking back now, I can't even imagine that they did that. But and then they went back, and then we started the next scene. Like, there was just so much time in the day for so many things, and especially running them. I mean, Stephen and I used to get coffee with maybe sugar and milk and some M&Ms and sit and run lines in the afternoon. I mean, we don't do that now. Good time, Stephen. I was just telling my daughter today, it's about parenting, even just how, when you're in it, you're so in it and you don't realize, and then you're on the other side and you're like, "Wow, that was really great times." So that's us too. Great times.
And it goes by like that.
There was a comment about daytime actors being some of the hardest working actors in the business, and how much you have to do and how fast paced it is. Do you have any tricks that you use for memorizing all the lines?
I'm a visual person, so it always helps me to write everything down. I actually write it out. And when there's a lot, I really write it out. I have to write it out. And I take walks and learn my lines while walking. Somehow the movement and just having, more oxygen to the brain, it helps me memorize. And it gets harder and harder. I mean, in the beginning, I would work maybe half an hour, 2 hours, half an hour or an hour on a script. I'm talking a script with a lot of dialogue. And I would pretty much have it and come in and rehearse the next day. And I would bring my script to the set. I rarely picked it up. But those days are gone. Those days are gone. I have to check and I have to look at it. And for the longest time, when that transition was happening, I felt guilty about it. It's like, you know, I shouldn't have to pick up my script, because I was taught in the theater, you show up off book day one of rehearsal, and that's it. You're off book. But you know, not in this medium. You have to get off book, but then you might have to check it and look at the script. So I've accepted that now, and I'm kinder to myself about that.
Mm-hmm. I mean, you're really off book. We're looking at it. They're kind of saying the count to start. They're saying the count, and we're setting our scripts down. Looking at it.
We're checking this.
And then I'll say to the stage manager, right, the last thing I'll be. What was that first line again? What? Huh? And then you just kind of hope that it all comes back to you. But
yeah,
I have to be at a certain level before I go to sleep at night. Like I have to have gone through it, have a pretty good memorization, pretty good before I go to bed. And then I have to review again in the morning, and then you just go over it and 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 over it. But I'm always shocked. Especially if you work like 5 days in a row, that you can really get that much in it. It's crazy. Yeah. But it's then again almost easier, because now, like for us having a week off, then you go back and it's like the cobwebs, you got to clean them out. But I'm so bad, I won't even look at them till like 2 days before. Anyway, next question. Yes, please.
You both have been playing these characters for so long and working at days for so long. How do you keep the work and your work within these characters interesting for you, for everyone else?
I would say for me, I'm interested. I'm still excited about it. I still am excited to go there, excited about the character. I'm excited for when we get some good story. And I'm even excited when I have my doctor junk, because I like all that too. I like being a compassionate, professional. And I really enjoy it. I don't know.
Well, I like working with Mary Beth so much.
And there's that.
And it's always interesting, because she's spontaneous and I can just play off whatever she's doing. And I also enjoy when I'm working with new people I've never worked with before, because it always, keeps you on your toes, and you're just, it's a whole different vibe with a new person.
Right.
I enjoy that. It's like a lot daytime these days now, at least on our show anyway, it's two people standing across from each other talking, and that's not very interesting. So
we try to make it interesting. All we have is connection. That's all you have.
Sort of get under that, try to get deeper and under that somehow.
Right.
And sometimes you don't know how that's going to happen. And other times, it just happens naturally. And it depends on who you're working with too. When you're working with good actors, it's always easier. Always.
You guys have often talked about the connection, and you kind of had it from the start. Have you had to work at it? Have you had to work to keep it?
No,
not at all. It's a magical thing. The thing Mary Beth and I have, I don't know. I haven't experienced that often in my life, just connecting with another person on such a deep level.
Yeah, I don't know why either, but we do.
We just have that thing. We must have, if there's such a thing as reincarnation, and sometimes I believe there is. We're probably, very close.
I never thought about that.
Yeah, we had to.
Maybe your name was like George and mine was Edith or something.
George and Edith.
Whatever. Cute. I like that.
So you talked about when you work with great actors, it's always easier. Are there actors that you've worked with in the past in the show that you'd like to see come back? Is there anyone that you're really good friends with?
I always loved Charlie Shaughnessy coming back.
I knew Mary Beth was going to say.
Love him. And I love George. He does. What does he go by now? Delahoya or something? What does he go by? Yeah.
Delahoya.
Yeah, he was on in the 80s when I was on. And I love him. He's the nicest person on the planet. And he's been back on, and that's been really, really fun. He kind of comes and goes, but he's the most conscientious, hardworking, he's one and sweetest guy.
He's a good friend of mine. We've really formed a bond and deep friendship from the time he came back, 3 years ago or so, after all those years.
Yeah, so sweet. So,
Yeah.
And a handsome devil then and now.
Handsome and very talented and always prepared and always in it and wanting to do a good job.
He'll be out on the set. Well, they're not with COVID, but normally he would be out on the set when nobody's even out there, just running his lines and his
rehearsing
and his
by himself on the set.
Yeah. Yeah. Very, very committed.
Okay, now I'm going to shift to some non-days related questions. What is something that people misunderstand about you?
Like what people? Anybody? People in general?
Let's say the public or your fans. What do they maybe not know or understand about you?
Gosh, I feel like I'm so straightforward. I don't know what there would be to misunderstand.
There's nothing about Mary Beth.
I'm an open book.
What you see is what you get.
I would say maybe with you, I could say more what I think people misunderstand about you.
Maybe you can answer that for me because I don't
know. I think people think that you're probably more serious because you're actually really funny. I mean, hardly anyone makes me laugh the way you make me laugh. And
except so Charlie Shaughnessy.
Yeah, maybe. He's pretty dang funny.
And Tristan Rogers, you said made you laugh.
Oh, right? Yeah, because he's got that Cheshire Cat smile thing. He's very funny. But you make me, I mean, gosh, you and I've had some of the funniest, you know, we'll be writing lines or doing something, then I'll be like this, just laughing my head off. So I would say that you actually are way funnier than people might think you are.
Yeah, I guess people generally think
you're serious.
I'm serious and I come off that way, and it's not anybody's fault. I mean, that's just how I come off.
Yeah, I don't think
maybe I do take myself too seriously, but I think less and less as I get older, I don't take myself as seriously.
You shouldn't say that with Mandy here because she knows you better than, on those notes. But
I don't. Do I? Never mind. Don't answer.
He's a lot funnier. He's a lot funnier. Okay.
I would say he's gotten a lot more relaxed than even like a few years ago when I was working on a project.
Okay.
So somebody gives you a round trip ticket to anywhere in the world and you've got a week off. Where are you going?
I want to go to France or Italy and get rent a house with a gravel driveway and some bicycles with a little farmer's market down the road where I get the fresh vegetables and a baguette. And I want all my kids and grandkids. And that's what I want to do for my 60th birthday, but then there was COVID. So someday, maybe the next 5 years, I want to do that and take the whole group and, get a VRBO or something. And of course I don't think they call it that there, but just something like that. Go and, really live the life for a week. I mean, a week's not long, but that seems like all we ever take off, but and just cook the fresh things and, I just think that sounds so fun. What about you, Stephen?
Yeah, traveling is a little dicey right now, but
I know.
We'll just assume that it's okay and you can go anywhere you want to go. I will definitely want to go to Costa Rica to see my son, who I haven't seen in a couple of years now. And he's got 150 acres there, a farm. He's got three cows. He has a bull named Ferdinand. He has a brand new little dog. He has a horse.
That's great.
He's farming. He's building a life there in Costa Rica. And I don't think he's ever going to come back. So,
well, then you definitely really need to get down. Him.
I want to jump on a plane and take longer than a week. I have to go there and really spend some time. And the pictures he sends me are, oh my God, they're just beautiful.
Oh, you have to show me next week. I want to see that.
Gorgeous, tropical.
Oh, that's amazing. Place. That's so nice.
It's really beautiful.
Beautiful.
And he's having a new house built and with a guest house.
Oh, there you go. That'll be your spot.
I can retire there. I don't know.
Oh, that would be sweet. But then I'd have to make the big trek, come to see you. I'm sweating, coming across the beach. So I'm saying.
Well,
where have you been?
This place is way out in the boonies. I mean, I think he said it was something like 2 hours from the airport.
I'll find you. I'll always find you.
You will. I know.
All right. Now a question, individual question for each of you. Stephen, you have talked about your woodworking projects. Someone's curious if you still paint and draw.
I haven't done a lot lately because I struggled for 8 years painting my wife, painting a portrait of my wife. And I'm telling you, I actually took some classes at some point, and I did study art in high school, and I was on my way to, you know, study, you know, formally, and I didn't do it. I did other things. I became a monk instead. But I'm just very slow and meticulous, and it takes me forever to finish a thing. And I don't have time. Unless I'm doing an abstract or something, then where I can really just throw paint on a canvas and just make it up as I go, and I don't have to be, doesn't have to be perfect, then I can do that. I can do that pretty quickly, and I do enjoy that. I still have my easel. I have paint. I have everything I need. I can do it again. But right now, I'm more focused on making a film. So.
He also did just paint his whole, the whole exterior of his house. He has been painting.
That's a different kind of paint.
I know. I once said to my husband something. He said he had a job as a framer, you know, when he was in high school or something. I'm like, God, you build houses and stuff? That's amazing. He goes, no, you know, picture frames. I'm like, oh,
yeah.
Picture frames. Okay.
All right. Mary Beth, for you, somebody commented that they were inspired by the storylines of the 80s to adopt their children. Mm-hmm. And now that their children are grown, their adopted children are grown, they are interested in getting involved. They heard you were involved with CASA, and they wanted to hear about how you got involved. And are you still involved?
You know, I got involved because right at that time, there was that horrible story about a boy who died in with his family, I think, and the social workers had been out a bunch of times, and they didn't catch the problems, and this kid died. And I kept thinking, God, they need an army of volunteers or things to, because, you know, social workers are so overworked and they don't have enough time. And then soon after that, then I read about CASA, which is a court-appointed special advocate. And it's the coolest organization. And Mandy became one, too. The court, they would like everybody to have a CASA, but they take the high risk kids, and they need like a special person that's like keeping an eye on these kids and interviewing all the people that are involved in the kid's life and going to see them. And sometimes you make educational decisions for them, and you just make sure that they are being well taken care of and they have the things that they need. And if there's something that you see that they need, like I had a boy who, he had been away from his family for like 10 years. Amazon. And and it was time for him to go home. And I knew it, and I interviewed everybody that knew it, and we got him back to his original family, which was an amazing thing. And he went from not even giving me eye contact and being so withdrawn and a troublemaker kind of in school to a happy kid who was so happy to see me and so happy with his family. And I followed up a couple times, and he was doing really well. So I know Jen Lilly did some for infants. I think she did like emergency fostering, and she adopted a couple of things you can do. That is amazing, and it's through the court system. And even if you don't have time to take on a child, you can volunteer at the courthouse to be when they bring kids in on a county bus or whatever to get there, and they don't have anyone with them there. You can just be the person that's at the courthouse hanging with them so they're not alone. So it's a really, really cool thing. And you can give a lot of your time or a little of your time, but it's national. So you should look into it for sure. I actually, since I went, done more fundraising for them than I've done having kids, but there's a million ways that you can work with them and help out. And I tell every last person I meet that they, and I give them the information about it. And so it's a really cool organization.
You guys have portrayed such a great example of true love on screen, and you both seem to be happily married in real life. Somebody's asking if you have advice you would give someone on love and relationships.
So many things. But one, I with my kids too, with their relationships, I always say communication is the number one thing, and it's not easy. And sometimes I hate the when you ask somebody what's wrong and they say nothing. It makes me berserk. So I really get in on that. Like, that's really wrong. But I think it's also perseverance, and don't throw in the towel. And and try to work things out. And I just say to my husband the other day that I think it's such a gift to ourselves, number one, but to our kids and grandkids that we're together, because, you know, we both come from broken homes and we know what it's like to have to shuffle around to the different parents and different grandparents. And it's a lot. And it's a really, it's a gift, I think, to be able to stay together and for, like I said, yourselves, but for your family. And Stephen and I say that Stephen and I should be in the book of records to live in Los Angeles. And we're both married for 35 years for me, 36 for him. And we've been together about that much time as a character couple. Of course, we've had our few, you know, the chip in the head and the different reasons that we were divorced, which that doesn't happen in my real life. But we always, true love always wins out, and we always find our way back.
Yeah, I hope we don't have to do that again.
Yeah, yeah.
We have to settle into, you know, staying together now, I think.
Yeah.
A couple of things. It's respect is number one, is respecting this other person and what they need. And on the other side of that is not being too needy, not leaning too much on the other person, giving them space.
Yeah, I'm not needy. I'm not needy. Are you needy? I'm not needy at all. I'm very happy buzzing about my day, I have to say.
Yeah, yeah. So, yeah, I just think, and as you say, communication, listening. My wife taught me very early, if I'm not looking at her when she's speaking to me, oh man, she gets so mad. Are you listening?
Oh my gosh. Okay. I have a 10 battery. I have 10% battery left. Eek. Okay.
Sweetheart, why do you start these things with a low battery? You know how to put it on low power mode? I actually
had to change a flight today. And you know, Delta, if you're on that phone for like 4 hours.
I'm wasting that 10% right now.
Okay. I won't tell my story.
You know how to put it on low power?
Let's get in our last few questions here on my low power.
I have one last question, and it's sort of a hodgepodge of a bunch of people's questions, because there was so much commentary about your connection with each other, your friendship. There were people who were like, what do your spouses think? And oh my gosh, have you ever dated? Not asking those questions, but if you were to describe your friendship, your relationship, how would you describe that? It's a unique one, I think, for most people.
I think, well, one is an actor. We trust each other and we're not embarrassed or self-conscious in front of each other. And, with the exception of a play that we did, I would say we work really well together because it's no big deal to say, maybe you need to do it like that, or you said that wrong, or like nobody takes offense, but I think he knows for me too, we're both honest, heartfelt people, emotional, so, you know, we're just good people and straightforward. We don't play games and we look into each other's eyes and we do a scene and it's like everything else falls away and we're connected and we listen to each other. And his wife trained him well because he gives me good eye contact. I think we just generally love each other. I mean, can you always explain why you love someone? I don't know.
Well, yeah, it comes from love, because I think that mutual respect comes from love, and love is not just, you know, sweet nothings and talking. It's not talk. It's actions. Love is an action.
Right.
And Mary Beth and I treat each other with respect, and we do things for each other, and we think about each other's needs. And I think that's the same in a marriage. You know, you have to really be focus on the other person a lot of the time, trying to figure out what it is, anticipating their needs. Yeah. I think that's
and when important. When there was been lulls, or the show was, you know, either we were not on the show, or, you know, whatever the situations were that we were not together, we made a point to call each other, check in with each other, meet for lunch, you know, whatever. So it's not, we care enough about each other and, you know, always try to pay attention to each other. Right, poops.
Okay, wait. I got two quick fun ones now.
Okay.
We'll have a moment. Stephen, will you bring the harmonica back to Days?
at some point, when I played the harmonica, in the very beginning, in fact, I even made up a couple of songs and played them on air, on shows, which is, you know, it's just a little riff here and there. It's not a big deal. I think I need to talk to some people and see it, because I noticed they don't, it's not in the script. But I think it's good to have that. I mean, it's good to have the harp around. It's part of the character from the very beginning. So I would like to play more.
I like it.
Mary Beth, for you, somebody noticed that you or Kayla always smiles as she's going in for a kiss with Steve.
Is that love it? Because I love him so much. That is why. That is why. Plus, I like to bring to our relationship the connection and the lightness and the love. I think that I do that a lot, actually, and I know it, and it's because I feel like where we are as characters at this time in our lives, that it is cute and sweet and lovable and adorable. And I think that Kayla feels like that about Steve, and I like to add that a lot, because she looks at him and she loves him and all those things. She thinks he's cute and funny, and I just think we've been together a long time, and I think that's just a nice quality than to always be so serious. I don't want to be so serious. Right.
Yeah.
Right.
I like it.
I do too. Oh yeah. All right, you guys. Well, sorry that we had to meet up with our garden hats on, but what the hell? You know, it's summertime and
take your hat off, baby. Take your hat off.
Oh, it's not good. It's a lot of hair. Let's see yours. Here, let's both do it. Here's mine. Okay.
Like this.
All right, friends. All right. Until next time. Take care, everybody. All right. Bye-bye.
I'll see you later, honey.
Love you.
It was really nice talking to you.
My phone dropped. My phone dropped.
Bye now.
Bye. See you later.
I love you.
Bye-bye, Billy Ray.
Bye, Mandy.